Let all the world rejoice and say, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Praise we in songs of victory, that love, that light, which cannot die, and sing with hearts uplifted high. Alleluia. The life laid down, the life restored.
Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia.
We rise and we join together in worship and praise of our risen and living Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We follow the order of divine service setting 1, and you can find that on page 151. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
If we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins.
We then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your presence and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you. And for his sake, he forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You may be seated for the Kyrie. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and their praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, We worship you, we give you thanks. We praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You oh, the Father, receive our prayer, for you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High. Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you. We pray together the collect for the day found printed for you on the insert inside of your worship bulletin. Almighty God, grant that we who have celebrated the Lord's resurrection may by your grace confess in our life and conversation that Jesus is Lord and God. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Old Testament lesson for the second Sunday of Easter comes from Ezekiel chapter 37. The hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the middle of the valley. It was full of bones. And he led me around among them, and behold, there were very many on the surface of the valley. And behold, they were very dry. And he said to me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, you know. Then he said to me, prophesy over these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. And I will lay sinews upon you, and will cause flesh to come upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I prophesied, there was a sound, and behold, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to its bone. And I looked, and behold, there were sinews on them, and flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath, prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood on their feet, an exceedingly great army. Then he said to me, Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. Behold, they say, our bones are dried up, and our hope is lost. We are clean cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God, behold, I will open your graves and raise you from your graves, O my people, and I will bring you into the land of Israel, and you shall know that I am the Lord, when I open your graves and raise you from your graves, O my people, and I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live, and I will place you in your own land. Then you shall know that I am the Lord. I have spoken, and I will do it, declares the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle lesson comes from 1 John chapter 5. For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? This is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. Not by the water only, but by the water and the blood. And the Spirit is the one who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. For there are three that testify, the Spirit and the water and the blood. And these three agree. If we receive the testimony of men, the testimony of God is greater, for this is the testimony of God that he has borne concerning his Son. Whoever believes in the Son of God has the testimony in himself. Whoever does not believe God has made him a liar, because he has not believed in the testimony that God has borne concerning his Son. And this is the word of the Lord. Please rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel.
Alleluia, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia, Alleluia.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 20th chapter.
Glory to you.
This will serve the basis for our meditation together this morning. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said unto them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of anyone, they are forgiven. If you withhold the forgiveness from anyone, it is withheld." Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails, and place my finger into the mark of the nails, and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We now join together with one heart and one voice, making bold confession of our faith in that triune God by speaking together the words of the Apostles' Creed. You can find those words printed for you on page 159. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated for hymn 461.
That my Redeemer lives.
My dear brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, He is risen. There's so much that happens during the Easter season that even today, and today's lessons begin last Sunday. There's so many wonderful things and events that go on that we take 7 weeks to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord. And so the words of our text come from the gospel lesson from John chapter 20, as was read for you earlier. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
This is my way to make sure you're always awake. I'd love to stand before you as your pastor and say how strong of faith I am and how faith-filled I am and the trust that's there. But I'll be honest with you, there are times that that's just not the case. There's so many things in my life that I look at and go, I doubt that. I just don't see how in the world that's possible. I mean, just simple, stupid little things. I'm driving around. Nobody told me, by the way, in South Sioux City that we have a National Mow Your Lawn Day, which is the day after Easter. I just did not know it. Everywhere I went, everybody's mowing. So I had to come home Monday night and mow my lawn very quickly. I didn't want to stick out. But here's the thing I noticed. As everybody was mowing their lawn was nice and green and growing so well. And mine partly is. And then there's part of it that's not. And I know that it's the original sod that was laid down for my house because it was a demonstration model for people to look at and all that kind of stuff. And so part of the sod was laid, and then after I bought it, the rest of the sod was laid. Well, the new sod that's laid is growing really nice and green like everybody else's, but the original sod is brown, and you see little scants of green coming through. And I can't help but look at everybody else's lawn on National Mow Your Lawn Day and go, mine's never going to get green. It's never going to look like that. I doubt that could ever come about. Because if it would, why is some of it growing and others of it's not? I don't understand it. That's just something trivial and simple. And yet when we come into things more challenging, I want you to do me a favor. I want you, if it helps you to close your eyes by all means, but I want you to picture yourself in the position of the disciples on the greatest day of Christian faith and celebration, the resurrection of our Lord. I want you to imagine yourself being in a room and have some women come and tell you that He is risen. See, you got to pay attention, don't you? He is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
You got to understand that they just saw their Savior up there suffering such agony and dying and buried and the tombstone closing and the threat that now comes against them because the body, according to all popular opinion, was stolen. And you know who did it? The disciples did it. You're one of those disciples. You're there. You're a follower. You learned at the feet of Jesus. You were there at the crucifixion. You were an eyewitness. You saw it. You saw Him buried. And then the group of women that went to prepare His body comes back and tells you that good news. They're overjoyed because they saw Jesus alive. And your response would be, at least my response would be, yeah, you know women, the way they talk and how they exaggerate, right? Or anybody when you come down to it. Because you see, all of a sudden, they have to check it out. Peter and John go running to the tomb. They see it. They see that it's empty. And they come back immediately come back. They run into the room. They lock the doors. They close the windows. They look around them with paranoia. You look around you in paranoia because you know the Roman guards are out there, and you already saw what the Pharisees did to Jesus, so they're certainly not afraid to do it to you. And you're locked in that room. It's Easter Sunday. It's the evening. And you're scared. The sun is going down. And you're still looking around. Every single noise you hear, you think somebody is coming right after you to arrest you, to kill you, because they're going to find the empty tomb. Those guards are gone. They had to have gone and told Pilate. And the Pharisees and the Sanhedrin, the church, ruling church council, they all have to know. And you found a great hiding place. The breeze of the wind comes through. The creaking of the building. Yeah, you know what? Here's what's happening. They're coming after you. You know that they are. And then all of a sudden, as you hear this noise and you're looking out the window, just peeking through, all of a sudden from behind you is the words, "Peace be with you." Peace? Right now? I doubt it. In fact, I don't want to be crude, but have you ever been scared so bad that maybe a little accident or so might happen? Can you imagine the fear that has been built up? One of the longest days in the life of these disciples, in your life. And then all of a sudden you turn around and you see a ghost. It has to be a ghost. What the women told you this morning could not be true. It has to be a ghost. Peace be with you. That's what the ghost says. You see, they were scared of the Jews. Jesus came, said, "Peace be with you." No, even the disciples doubt this. So what does Jesus have to do? He has to show them. Feel. Touch. It's got to be real. It has to be there. I want you to know that the resurrection is full and strong and real. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah.
He is risen.
Do you understand the joy, the mixed emotions to go from sadness to fear to shock? Or we can say shock and awe, can't we? And then what joyous relief. Now the celebration begins. For they do what they have to do. They touch, they feel, they check. And it says, and I think very mildly, then, it says, then the disciples were glad. You see, everything that was building up, there was no gladness, there was no happiness, there's no joy. Not like last Sunday in the early morning, where we make it very joy-filled, certainly, but there's no joy, none, until the evening of the resurrection of our Lord. Until that evening, after they were scared, all of a sudden, they saw what the women said were true. They saw it with their own eyes. They felt it with their own hands. They were so overjoyed that when Thomas, who was not there, showed up, and he gets a very bad rap, by the way, because he gets a title that's called for to this very day. He's not just called Thomas, but he's called Doubting Thomas. In fact, if somebody doesn't believe something that they should, we will even use that term. Well, you're such a doubting Thomas. That's a bad rap, because to be honest with you, so did the other 10. The other 10 disciples doubted until they put their hands in his hands and they put their hands in his side. Until that happened, there was no joy. There was nothing but doubt. There was no peace. There was nothing but doubt. Think about it. When you go through what you do go through in your life, it could be something as simple as, everybody else's grass is green, mine's not green. I doubt that I'm going to have a good lawn this year. Who cares? Or you have somebody who has to endure cancer. I doubt that there can be any recovery whatsoever. The doctors say there's no possibility. I doubt that my husband will be able to make it back safely again. I doubt that my wife will be able to get strong again. I doubt that my family can come back together. I doubt that our church can be built up. I doubt that this country could be great again. I doubt it. And peace, to hear the words of peace of Christ being spoken to me personally, yeah, I doubt it. It's fine in this place, in these four walls. This is where I expect to have it. But let's be honest, this gets to be an escape. It gets to be escape whenever we need it. This is not a place where we're built up and we're fed and constantly nourished so we can face the rest of the world with the peace of Christ. Oh, no. This becomes a reserve. You see, we run away like the disciples do in fear, with such great fear that we don't know where else to turn or what else to do, but only as a last resort, we turn toward the risen Christ. But my dear friends, we also know the joy that we have when Christ comes down to us. When he reaches to us through his word and his sacrament, we are fed, we are nourished, we are strengthened. We know the joy of the resurrection. We know the joyous response of he is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
We know that in our lives and we live it day in and day out. But there are so many Christians, just Christians who doubt. And if we doubt the resurrection of our Lord, and if we doubt the power of Almighty God, and we doubt the forgiveness that he has won for us, how in the world can we ever think or expect unbelievers to believe it when we don't always believe it ourselves? You see, it comes down to the fact that the word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword, and it cuts within us. When we take the word of the law upon ourselves and see that it is my sin that creates that fear, my sin that does not give me any peace whatsoever, my sin that separates me from God, and my sin that separates me from you. And until that happens, how in the world can I ever believe? Until he comes to us with his very body and his very blood, and he gives to us of himself. Yes, stop doubting and believe. The fact that Thomas didn't believe is not that surprising. The fact that the disciples didn't believe and they saw him there is more surprising. The fact that they all doubted, well, why wouldn't they? I mean, after all, think about it. If you think about it, they saw him die with their own eyes. He was dead. But maybe like some spindly grass, maybe some new life can start to come through. And it's so vibrant and beautiful. Maybe, just maybe, through the power of the Holy Spirit that works in us, the doubt is removed. The fear is gone and peace is put in. There's nothing that the world and Satan and my own sinful flesh can ever throw against me that the risen Christ cannot handle himself. We focus through the cross on the empty tomb, and what we truly see is life. Life that gives us peace in this world, because we now have life in the world to come. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, do you doubt it anymore? Maybe for the moment you don't, but I can guarantee you that when we leave this place, Satan and the world and my own sinful flesh will continue to bother me and tempt me and try to draw me away. But when we open up his word and we keep gathering together as brothers and sisters in Christ, our words are words of encouragement and empowerment and strength. We are lifted up and we give him all the praise and the glory and honor. We are children of God and we stop doubting, not because we want to, we always want to, but because we allow the Holy Spirit breathed into us to take care of us, and we can be at peace. Peace that will last forever. To God be that glory and you that blessing. Amen. And now may that peace of God, which surpasses all of our human understanding, let it keep your hearts and your minds and your lives in him, now and all the way to life everlasting. Amen. With thanksgiving in our hearts, and total and complete trust in our Almighty God, we lovingly, trustingly, and joyfully offer back to him the first fruit offerings of our hearts as well as of our hands. We pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. O Almighty God, like Thomas and with the disciples, we wrestle with faith and doubts and fears. Grant us your Holy Spirit so that by believing in you, we may see. And in seeing, we may rejoice in your Son and the power of his resurrection. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord God, you know the hearts of your people and those who have wandered into error or fallen away from the faith. Rekindle faith within them and restore them to the fold, that their voices may be one with us in prayer and praise again. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord God, the threats against us are great, but you are greater than that even. Deliver us from conflict, from wars and oppression, and provide for us good, wise, and honorable leaders who will serve the causes of justice and freedom for all. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, without your guidance, we are lost. Give to your church faithful pastors who will preach faithfully at all times, and faithful missionaries through whom your word extends to those still in the darkness of sin and death. Bless those at call day this week at the seminaries, those who will be receiving their vicarage assignments as well as calls into the ministry. We pray that you guide and bless the church and the people together, that your kingdom may be built up here on earth and may be extended all the way to paradise with you. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord God, the trials and the troubles of this life weigh heavy on us. Give to those who are sick and those who suffer the consolation of your grace and healing according to your will. Be with especially Keith Safar, Gene Chester, Tom Grau, Diane Guthridge, Preston Thielman, Kim Dahm, and Rob Langenberg. Be with Ann Ortman, Tanner Haberman, Kim Fales, Matt Legrand, and Josh Legrand. Be with Rich Steffens, Mary Bowes, Susan Utek. Be with Sarah Hansen and Beth, Ron Peters, Ken Todd, Donna Singleton, and Marty Delperdang. Be with Renee Neeson, Kathy Mast, Pastor Jeff Walsh, Teresa Santee, K.P. Brigham, and Berkeley Johnson. Be with Marianne Lau, Kristen Coots, Paula Stoll, Arnold Awe, and Daryl Austin. Be with Howie Holenreed, Jane Winter, Ed Stone, Jerry Wendt, Kimberly Christensen-Bolke. Be with Mary Van Cleve, Shannon, Phyllis Klingenpeel, Pastor Klaus Robb, and Pastor Henry Witte, both who will be having surgeries this week. Give them courage and confidence and peace in all their circumstances, that their eyes of faith may always be focused squarely on you, the risen and living Lord. Lord, in your mercy. O gracious Lord, defend your church here on earth, the pastors and people that faithfully come together in your name. Be with especially those at Emmanuel Lutheran Church in Laurel, Nebraska, Peace Lutheran Church in Columbus, Nebraska, our Redeemer Lutheran Church in Elwood, Nebraska, at St. John Lutheran Church in Battle Creek, Iowa, the entire Mid-South District, the faculty, the staff, and the students at Concordia University in Seward, Nebraska, our brothers and sisters at the United Methodist Church in Dakota City, Nebraska, and the Living Water EFC Church in South Sioux City. Keep them in your care and grace, O Lord. Build them up, that faithfulness to you and your word, your name may be proclaimed to the ends of the earth. Lord, in your mercy. All Lord of life, you've shown us that you are not a Lord of death, but of life through your resurrection. And you promised to give us that everlasting life with you and all your saints in paradise for all who put their faith and trust in you. We thank and praise you for the faith that you've given to your servant, Becky Schroeder, and the fruits of that faith she now enjoys with you in paradise. Comfort Kathy, the daughter of Becky, Kathy Mast, and the family and friends who grieve this loss. Help them through the tears of grief to see life, everlasting life, and looking forward to the reunion with Becky and all your saints in paradise. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We rise and pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord now bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. You may be seated for hymn 477. You may be seated. He is risen. Welcome to everyone and to all of our guests. We'd like to extend a very special welcome to you. It is truly wonderful having you worship with us this morning. And it is our prayer that this service has been helpful, beneficial to us all as we gather together as God's children to give Him all the worship, the honor, and the praise. Please come back. Worship with us again real soon. A couple of announcements. There is Bible class that will be in the gym. And we're continuing Genesis, and we'll be looking at the sacrifice of Isaac in Genesis 22. That's right, we're not even halfway, so leave me alone. But I will keep that promise. You're going to learn something new today. You will. You're going to learn something you didn't know. Also, you're fine. No, thank you, Ed. Poor thing. Tuesday, right, Carl? Tuesday. If you'd like to go to Mission Central, there is a group that is going to help serve a meal and everything, and you get to learn about what's going on at Mission Central. And Carl would certainly love and appreciate the help with the cooking and the serving. Please talk to Carl Peterson, not Carl Henshaw, because you'll get nowhere if you talk to Carl Henshaw. But Carl Peterson would love for you to be able to do that. And that's this Tuesday. What time are you leaving? Yeah, usually there is. Yeah. Usually there is. So you'll get to hear one of the missionaries that's on furlough back and will present on the work that God is doing through them. I actually have a list of them. But I don't remember who it is. What time are you planning on leaving?
About
9 o'clock from here or over there by 10:30-ish. So that'll be great. So yeah, by all means. You'll love doing it. All right, Ed's got something he wants to tell you.
Yeah, I've got my Memorials Committee hat on this morning. I hold here my formerly nicotine-stained fingers, the wish list. What this is for is department heads of all the committees and boards. We've got a wish list. The Memorials Committee, we've got an account established at the bank. And now we need some ideas as to what kind of projects could be done around the church. So if you're head of a board or if you're on a committee that has any vested interest in memorial-type projects, please feel free to see me and get one of these forms, fill it out, and turn it in, and we'll see what we can do about that. Thank you.
Thanks, Ed. Missions. All right. Any other announcements? Have a nice day. In Jesus Christ, have a nice forever.